action shots.
Okay, I'm Lynn Fisher, and we're here today interviewing filmmaker Renee Pinnell, who is both a filmmaker, director, and writer, and Lou Perryman, who is a veteran actor and acted in many of Eagle Pinnell, who happens to be Renee Pinnell's uncle, in many of his independent films. And Elliot Cole, who has appeared in Renee's films, a number of Renee's films, as well as Leah Stinson. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Renee, I just want to kind of start this off finding out what drew you to filmmaking.
I think I've always had a really, really unusual interest in film, and I think it's because of my father. When I was a little kid, we used to watch lots and lots of movies together, and I really attribute my fascination with film to my dad, more than anything else.
And there's an obvious connection as well, another family connection with the films of your uncle, Eagle Pinnell. And I, since we have Lou here, I just wanted, well, both of you to kind of speak to the influence that he's had on your filmmaking, and then find out a little bit from Lou, his experience of working with Eagle, both in the artistic process and in the kind of historical perspective of that time in the making of independent films.
Back in the old days.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, let's take them in that order.
You said you didn't ever see any of these films, right?
Yeah, that's actually the interesting thing. I think my dad had a close connection to film because of Eagle,
and he scored some Eagle.
Yeah,
films,
and it's
right?
And it, he my dad was had a lot to do with film because of Eagle, and it's through that Eagle influenced me. I have no recollection of ever meeting Eagle. The only connection that I had with him was when I was about 8, he gave me a blue plastic Frisbee for my 8th birthday. He also came to my graduation when I graduated from high school, but interestingly enough, I didn't meet him there. He came to the stadium where the graduation ceremony was, and but he left before I got back. So he was actually there in the room, but I never met him. And it wasn't until he died that I'd actually seen any of his films. I didn't know that I'd only heard the bad stories about Eagle. I never knew that he was a talented filmmaker until he died and all the people came out of the woodwork talking about what an important filmmaker he was.
He sort of was in a... in a stepping stone way of there's somebody before us and there's somebody after us. It was a stage in independent film in Austin that had been preceded by others with Chainsaw Massacre, films before that. There was a really weird war movie made here out in Spicewood Springs area, out in the Cedars, and stuff called None But the Brave years ago. You know, so it's one film after another, and Eagle came along, and I like to think I sort of prepped him in saying, here's what I've seen. I've seen people spend 2-3 years trying to raise money to make a movie and never make a movie, or get $10,000 worth of money to look for money instead of making a $10,000 film.
Mm-hmm.
And I like to think Eagle took that and said, let's make it for whatever we can make it on. And I think we made the first one. Hell no, it was made for like $1,200 or something.
Mm-hmm. And can you talk a little bit about the process that you, the kind of the creative process in working with Eagle, how y'all worked together?
Well, that one started out to be a show about, I think, 4 or 5 different stories on a Saturday night. I think it was called Saturday Night. And I think he shot part of some other stuff and maybe didn't have the money, and he just focused on this thing with myself and a guy named Sonny Davis. And I remember he said, there's this guy named Sonny Davis that I think y'all would look good together or work well together. He was in a band called the Uranium Savages, really kind of a, you know, like the Lounge Lizards on something. You know. And so he focused on that, and we just were sort of writing it down little by little what was going on. We'd have, you know, okay, let's repossess the guy's car. I mean, Eagle was running it and writing it. And then at some point, it's a Saturday night show, and there was a guy that got killed down at the Armadillo in the same sort of incident, a mistaken identity. He tried to shoot somebody, and he'd shoot somebody else. Mm-hmm. And we said, hey, let's kill Sonny. And so we killed Sonny. And that we just made it up, mm-hmm. really. And it was a matter of people believing in independent film to the degree that when we went to the final show, I mean, I was amazed. There were people out there helping. There were people out there that knew what they were doing. They were helping put up big lights and, you know, because they love film, you know.
Mm-hmm. So it was much more an endeavor of passion and
definitely
making art.
Oh yeah, we had
as
jobs.
As opposed to the commercial.
At least I did. I mean, I had a company, you know, and was shooting sports on the weekend, working on films. And
mm-hmm.
I was working behind the camera, and then on the weekends I'd get out and try to do something, you know, and pretend like I knew what I was doing.
All I want to say is assholes and elbows, assholes and elbows.
Like the sound of that, do you?
I take it you don't.
No, I don't, Mr. Fart. If you don't get off of my ass, I'm going to get a piece of yours.
That does it, Johnson. You're fired.
Well, suits me fine, Mr. Poot. I was looking for a job and I found this one.
Get back to work. Done wasted the best part of a day.
Shit on that. Lincoln done freed the slave.
Stick it up your ass, Mr. Poot.
Sideways.
Don't come no closer.
That'd be hard as fast as you're going backwards. This is what we think of you and your fucking ruling.
And what do you think was unique about working with Eagle and the way that he worked? As you said, he was a writer as well as a director.
He trusted people, but still we made his act. He, in the Hitchcock way or the whoever way, the Woody Allen way, you pick the right people. And he did pick some good people, and I guess I must include myself. Because he left it to those people then to make something up and do it. And, you know, you generally blocked for the camera so that everybody knew what was going on, but you just sort of made it up. And we had to have the fight. You know, Eagle went over. There was a movie shooting in town called Outlaw Blues. He went over there and got buddies with the sound, with the special effects guy or the props guy. And he brought this breakaway bottle. And we carried it around like it was a light bulb, you know, and put it in the glove box and wrapped it in cloth and everything. And when it came time for me to whack this guy, it was hard as a rock. It was plastic. I mean, it's hard plastic. Yeah, it breaks away and it doesn't cut you, but it was hard and it knocked the guy out. And so I was kicking the guy and I saw him bleeding. And, you know, the guy hung in there and, you know, he finished the show that night, you know.
First cousin's sister or something like that. A half-sister, I think
she's
a half-sister.
Well, Norma. I thought that I'd find you here. Yeah.
Go away, Bubba.
Huh? I'm not going anywhere, Norma. Not until you come with me.
Look, we're through. And I'm getting pretty tired of you bird-dogging me around. I got my own life now, and it doesn't include you.
Now, Norma, I know that you don't mean that. I just want you to pick up your things and want you to come on and get out of here with me right now. Now, come on, get this and let's go.
Look, when are you gonna get it through your fat head that I ain't going anywhere with you?
I think it's time for you to hit the road, buddy.
Okay, I think it's time you stayed out of this, Mr. Hippie.
Well, I'll just get in it all I want to, Shorty.
No. It's one thing to beat a man. You've already done that. That's sorry, bugger. Another thing to shame a man. You should never shame a man.
And then, you know, you take it and you... you make something out of it. He rigged a thing down at Dobie to show it at a midnight show. Mm-hmm. And we said, damn, you know, we got to get a premiere. And so we borrowed all these weird clothes and got these guys to drive us down in Lincoln's. And a friend of ours, Cecil, said, well, hell, as long as you're going to do that, I'll take pictures. So she went down there and set up some lights to take pictures. Well, a bunch of crowd got standing around thinking, something's going on here, you know? And so pretty soon we had this crowd, and we got out, you know, at a $1,200, 20-minute movie, and we're getting out waving at this crowd that doesn't know what the hell they're doing. Mm-hmm. And we go in, you know, and just make it up. I don't know. We were having fun.
Well, and Renee, how does this strike you kind of in terms, I kind of want to tie this back into your own process as an independent filmmaker. And, you know, kind of find out how you work, or does this sound familiar to you?
Yeah, it seems like surprisingly little's changed. I think it's the same, you know, working without any resources forces you to, you know, to do that kind of stuff.
Become, make it up.
Yeah, make it up, do it. And with the how cheap it is now to make films, you have a lot of freedom to make it up, you know? So you want to ask that question again?
Yes, I was curious to find out a little bit more about your process. For example, you were saying in Julia Thompson, A Case Study and The World of Maya, that, I mean, it's obvious that there's quite a bit of editing and very well done in telling the story in a certain way. And then, however, Hot Air is... more focused on, I believe, the characters or the writing of the characters and development of the characters and bringing them to life. And I just would like you to speak a little bit to that, both the different aspects and how you kind of marry them together. Or, as you said, sequentially, we see, you know, there are one is more emphasized than another.
Each project I set out to, I look at my last project, and generally it's not even a conscious thing, but I notice what the weak points are from my previous project, and I try to isolate those things and then come up with a project that will force me to work on those, which I feel like my editing is a very strong point. I feel very comfortable in it, and I feel like... I have a lot of talent in that area that is new and different, but I feel like my talent as a storyteller was sort of suffering up to the point of Hot Air. All of my pieces were not... they didn't really have characters exactly. It was more of how images with music and sound could produce emotions. You know, my characters were paper dolls. So with Hot Air, I wanted to work purely on character. So to do that, I decided that I'd take away all of the film elements and make a play, which I produced along with Elliot Cole and Austin Tyndall, who unfortunately couldn't be here. Austin and I co-wrote it together in about a month, and Elliot helped with that too. He was in on a lot of, we'd have group sessions where we'd all get together and work up to the point where we hadn't had any more of it written, you know, and try to figure out where we're going to go next with it. Particularly the ending. We had a lot of different endings for Hot Air. We were trying to work in, or I was trying to work in a gun at the end, and I didn't want him to kill himself, but that just wasn't going anywhere. It wasn't, it wasn't real, you know, it was forced.
It wasn't, the beginning didn't imply a gun. You know, yeah. it was a little out of place.
Uh-huh.
You can see what side I was on.
And then going with the thing that Eagle let his people do, I tried to let Austin and Elliot do a lot of their own character work.
The original idea, if I remember, was to have a mostly improvised...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mostly improvised play, where we'd set up the situations and the reality, but then play within that. And I think that developed the play as much as any of the conscious writing did, even though the final product wasn't really... improvised, because
yeah.
we had scripted it out. We scripted what came most naturally, I think.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely. We during rehearsal, you know, if something wasn't working out, we'd try to let it flow naturally and have it have them. And there were spaces which even in the final product was ad-libbed and improvised. So I think that spirit was still contained of letting them live in the moment and have them know the characters so well
mm-hmm.
that they could just be the characters on stage.
I think anything funny we made up on the spot.
Uh-huh.
If there's anything, everything it was just funny to me because it wasn't expected. But a lot, I do, you're right.
And what about, was Hot Air conceived of originally as eventually being a piece for film, a film, or, you know, was it, did you just want to have the theater experience, the experience of writing a play?
It was sort of a wait-and-see thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big believer in slapdash methods. Just do it. Make it happen. And so I was very, very focused in on the play. We did the whole play in a month, from writing it and... producing and everything. It was just about from conception to performance a month.
Mm-hmm.
So and then so once we had it, and I think it turned out, I was really happy with how the play turned out. I was very enthusiastic about it. I felt
mm-hmm.
like Elliot and Austin were real characters. And I really believed in them.
Mm-hmm.
And so at that point, I decided, and it was sort of concurrent with when we were producing the play, I was sort of milling about the idea of making it into a movie. But once I saw how it turned out, I was really enthusiastic for making that film. And it was actually, the whole film was made in 2 weeks, I think, too.
Mm-hmm.
We had a week break between when the performance ended and when we went into production.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to speak also to the collaborative process that you were talking about and how you all worked together. And the various roles that you had. Was it different doing it as a live theater piece as opposed to doing it as a film? And how did that transition?
The feeling that the play had and the film had were pretty different, which I think was actually to the play's benefit and the film's loss. Watching people on stage is very different than watching them on the television, and there was... that spontaneity that you really felt in the theater was a lot lost in the film. And also is in the fact that there's a certain permanence to film, whereas in theater, when you watch something happen, and if something messes up, if it's not right, it sort of washes over you, because you're there living it with them, and you're more a part of it, the audience is more a part of it. But when you're watching a film, you have... a farther perspective back on it, where you can be more critical, where you can pick out the things that didn't quite work. And we didn't have time to go back and make everything work in the film. It was pretty much like we were doing the play in real locations, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So when things messed up, we just went with it.
Mm-hmm.
When things didn't go like maybe they could have gone at best, you know?
Mm-hmm. And I'd like to ask both of you, both Elliot and Leah, about your experience in working with Renee as a director. You know, what your style is and how that relationship works.
Well, I enjoyed it a lot because I'm from an improvisational background, and so getting to do that on film was a blast. We knew he had his vision of what he wanted in each scene, and he told us, but then how we would make that work, we just, got to do on our own. So that was very fun. So it makes it more personal.
Mm-hmm. So there was a freedom and an atmosphere of safeness, I guess, to create.
Yeah.
For you as actors.
I see that.
How about you,
Ellie? I see that certainly. I like Renee's style a lot of directing. Every director's got a different kind of leadership style, mm-hmm. and a different way to tell you that you're doing it wrong, and a different way to communicate to you what he wants. And I thought mm-hmm. Renee was very effective in a very friendly way, which was really nice because it really did feel I got the excitement of the project more than if he was more controlling or more more controlling.
So I guess you're not a tyrant. You're not a tyrant.
Well,
doesn't
but
sound
he's not a tyrant, but he knows what he wants,
mm-hmm.
and he'll tell you.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And Lou, do you have anything to add? I mean, just in terms of your experiences, you've done lots of film and theater as well, and how you work with different directors.
Well, our style on the movie we made after Hell of a Note that'll be shown was a movie called The Whole Shooting Match. And we're shooting it on weekends. We have jobs. And we would rehearse during the week, and we had a rough sort of script, and we would start with that and then tape record it. And I just started tape recording it with this little Radio Shack recorder. And then when it came Saturday, we forgot. We had a whole week of stuff between and then. And so Sonny and I would just go out and sit in a truck and play that after we'd go and block it. And then we'd go play it, and we'd hear all of that build from the start to where we got it to where we liked it. And then we'd go on a set and do it. And so that's pretty much the way it was. There were times when, personal stuff came up, or, you missed something, or working with a tool or something that's loud and, you blow the sound or something like that and you got to go back. But generally, it was just, this is good enough. I remember one time on the shooting match, we went out to do this thing sitting in a truck. And Eagle took us out there and we ran through it a couple times. It was a long scene. It was probably 5 or 10 minutes long. And he says, y'all ready to try one? We said, sure, why not? So we try this long thing. When we get there, Eagle says, great, got it, great, let's wrap, let's go home. Years later we found out that's all the film he had. He had one 400-foot roll of film. So sure, we got it. Yeah.
Economics rules.
Damn right. Right. So you had to live with that. And, that's what you live with. If you do that, that's what you live with for the rest of time, So it goes.
Renee, I also want to ask you just kind of where your ideas come for your films. Because I know I've read a bit about all of these three films, and if you could just speak to Julia Thompson, A Case Study, World of Maya, and Hot Air, those three in particular.
All right. I love working with what I have. It's the only way that I can come up with anything. Just about all of my movies, I look at the resources that I have, the people I know, and then I try to think, how can I make a story from this? Julia Thompson, A Case Study, that came from, I had to make a 3-minute film, and I'd never done that before. So it was the time constraint, so I had to make it short, and And I'd been working on, I did a film, a photo shoot with a friend of mine where I had to tell a story in 9 pictures, and so I decided that I'd have a static camera and take 9 different shots of him being covered with food items. And I really liked the way it looked. It was very, it added this interesting texture and color to his body. It was very tribal. So I took that and I was like, how can I make a story with this image of covering people with food? And I was like, conflict, where's the conflict? Okay, they don't want to be covered with food. Why don't they want to be covered with food? They have a food phobia. But so why are they being covered with food then? It's therapy. It's got to be therapy. So I worked from that. It just sort of evolved from how can I do it with what I have.
Julia Thompson was put under my care by the New York State Hospital. She had been diagnosed with acute anorexia. However, after preliminary questioning, it became clear that she was actually suffering from Chibas phobia, or a fear of food.
Julia, why are you afraid of food?
Because my family has heart problems, and I could get high cholesterol and die of a heart attack.
Julia, there are lots of people who come from families with a history of heart problems, and they manage their cholesterol just fine. Do you think it's possible that you are overestimating your risk of heart failure?
Yes, but I just can't help it. I see food and I'm scared shitless. I can't do it.
I began treatment using systematic desensitization therapy.
You see, there's a sandwich, and this sandwich is a very special sandwich. It happens to make it to a room much like this room. Now, I want you to imagine that you are in the same room with the sandwich. Are you afraid?
No.
She responded well to cognitive restructuring.
Now, I want you to imagine that you are holding the sandwich.
We then confronted visual representations of feared stimuli.
Farm. Sheep. Leg of lamb. Are you afraid?
Yes, a little bit.
That's fine, you're doing very good. Let's try an easier one. Countryside.
There were a few minor setbacks, but on the whole, her progress was remarkably fast.
Apple. Now, I'm about to show you a steak made of rubber. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you afraid?
No.
Do you think you could touch it?
Yes.
Encouraged by success, I replaced the rubber steak with a real one.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Unfortunately, the last step proved to be too drastic, causing Julia to go into a semi-comatose state. Fearing a relapse, I administered severe operant conditioning.
I'm not ready. I'm too scared.
You're going to be fine.
I'm going to die. No, I'm not ready yet. I'm
not. This is for your own good.
I'm not ready yet. Not yet. No. I'm not. Not ready.
Stop it! No! Oh, God! Oh. Stop! Stop!
I'm pleased to say Julia is now a healthy and functioning member of society.
The world of Maya was, I had a very heavy stylistic image. I was like, I want to make this the most intricate, collage of elements. I want every little tiny space to be filled with something. And so I took that and that image and I kind of put it in a psychological text, of, I want someone, the character, to have this very textured kind of, psychosis, and so that's why I took a pure obsessive disorder, which is a type of obsessive compulsive disorder where they obsess about thoughts and images, you know. So that gave me a lot of freedom to do stylistic images that would mirror his thoughts. So that the plot sort of evolved from that that image and then that psychological problem that he had, and the plot was all derivative of what can I do with a person that has this disorder.
Hot Air was psychological too, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, and that all characters have things that go along in their head. And I was interested in your character mostly was sort of the driving force in the plot of this character who's stuck. Because there's these two characters, Coy and Andy. Andy, played by Elliot, who are best friends, but on the opposite ends of the scale. Coy loves life. He lives it very fully. Andy doesn't know how to love life. He's inert. He can't move. He's almost paralyzed. And it's sort of how these two things play together and how they both affect each other. How Coy affects Andy and how Andy affects Coy. And there's a
kind of, yeah, the process. The most interesting thing about the movie to me, about the idea, was the how the characters changed position. How it's kind of a Gilgamesh. I don't know. I kept thinking that we were writing Gilgamesh again. It was like,
really?
Yeah, it was like two very opposite people. One is humbled and one is empowered, and that was very satisfying to me to have such a sublimely resolving, even in its, I don't know, I felt a large amount of resolution at the end, even though mm-hmm. it was chaotic and didn't
your
seem
character
to be.
Elliot at the end seems to have the greater wisdom in a way, or at least be in touch with some truth in that. Coy, you say to him at the end, you don't really know how to love. You know, you're just the same as I am, and even though he, as you said, is passionate and participates in life, he still isn't making contact, real and true contact. And I think your
yeah.
character says at the end that at least I hate myself for it.
Yeah, some sort of consciousness, I think, was different and changed about me, was realizing that.
Mm-hmm.
And then leaving,
mm-hmm.
you know, closing the door.
Yeah, and it's as far as hot air goes, too, there are a lot of long handheld shots and that go on for quite a long time. And I just wanted you to speak a little bit about that and, you know, how it relates to having done it as a theater piece and then in film and the effectiveness of that for you. And
That was an attempt to recapture the immediacy and believability of theater. When there's one camera angle that's not cut, you know, it moves, but it's not cut, you have more of a feeling like you're really there watching something play out in real time. So with so many movies today, it's you don't have that. It's this hyper-reality, this other reality that's created by films. Whereas, and it becomes hyper-reality because of this different sense of time that films have. And so I was trying to, with these, the longest camera angle, I think, longest uncut shot was about 8.5 minutes. And in those 8.5 minutes, you see something play out like they would happen in real 8.5 minutes. It takes just as long. There's just as long pauses and where nothing's happening that happens in real life, where there's space, where people are just left to be.
Hello, my name is Andrew Perkins, and I represent a nonprofit organization. I was wondering if you'd like to answer a few questions. No, I'm nonprofit. I'm not selling you anything. Hello? Okay.
Hi, my name is Andrew Perkins, and I'm conducting a survey which will help prevent child abuse. Would you like to answer a few questions?
Good, excellent.
Well, first of all, about your diet. Do you eat cereal for breakfast?
Really? What kind?
Cornflakes, an excellent choice. I have partaken in some cornflakes myself through the years. So, have you ever thought about killing yourself or a loved one?
Well, why not?
No, I assure you, this has everything to do with child abuse. Okay, here, do you have any children?
And do you abuse them?
No, good, just what I like to hear. So I'll just mark you down here in the cornflakes not abusing children category. Good, well, this survey is to understand the psychology of good, upstanding parents like yourself. So, if you could answer a few questions about your worldview.
Good, okay. Well, first of all, what makes you get out of bed in the morning?
And by that I mean, what makes your life worth living?
Really?
Really? That's really interesting. Really interesting. Well, where is that again? Really? Okay, well, I'm still curious. Don't you ever get that feeling like you're 3 feet away from your own skin? And you see your life and everyone in it, but it's like they're behind plexiglass or something. And you want to touch things, but whenever you do, you're still 3 feet away from them. And you think if you could only get up high enough up on something, if you could climb and climb and climb until when you jumped, you'd get enough speed that you'd break through that 3 feet and hit the ground with your own feet. Do you?
No. You're right.
You're very, very right. This isn't a survey at all. No. It's just a joke. I'm pulling your leg. A prank call. Well, great. Excellent. Thank you very much. I hope you poop in your pants tomorrow. Good. You too, buddy.
Yep.
Andy, get the phone. Andy, the phone.
I'm busy.
Get the goddamn phone. Fuck.
What the fuck? God damn it, Andy.
It's not for you.
Oh, Andy.
Don't listen to him. He beats his kids.
Andrew Perkins. Yes, my asshole roommate who never picks up the goddamn phone. Yes, he's sitting right here, as a matter of fact, right next to the phone. Next to the very phone that was ringing that he didn't pick up. Who may I ask is calling? Andy, do you know a Carl Dunbar?
Yeah.
What can Andy do for you?
Is Carl on the phone?
Uh-huh. A party? Really? No, Andy didn't say anything to me. Well, sure, he'd love to come. We'd love to come. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right, well, Carl, could you tell me whereabouts this place is located? Uh-huh. Wait, you say that one more time? Where is that exactly? Really? So are you rich like Andy? No, seriously. Look, I'm just asking a question, okay? There's no reason to get all pissed off. No, Andy can't come to the phone right now. Seriously, though, are you as rich as Andy?
Nobody's as rich as Andy, Cor.
Look, I'm just trying to look out for Andy's well-being. No, I mean, Carl, you wouldn't want Andy going to, say, a middle-class party now, would you? I mean, just think of all the things that could happen. Mm-hmm. Well, that's right, Carl. Everybody should use caution. Uh-huh. Well, good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so about, what time is this going down? Right. Okay, well, listen, Carl. I'm gonna let you get back to your whatever. And I'll send Andy... No, he can't come to the phone right now. I'll send him your regards, okay? Mm-hmm. Yeah, bye. Thank you so much for picking up the phone.
Hey, no problem.
That was just so helpful.
Quite, I didn't pick up the phone.
Yeah, I know.
Oh. Yeah?
That was sarcasm.
Well, no problem, buddy. You know what? You know what? I'd not pick up 1,000 phones for you, buddy. 1,000 phones. A mile of phones.
Andy, I'm concerned. Why didn't you tell me about the party?
Oh, it must have slipped my mind, you know.
Andy, why it is that you are so dedicated to never having a good time?
Hey!
Is completely beyond me.
I resent that.
No, it's a serious problem.
I had a lot of fun today, thank you. Thinking about you in the shower. Hey, you got anything on under that?
You should put on some music.
What do you want to hear?
I really don't care. Yeah, shut up. I'm just gonna leave with my towel.
And actually, as an actor, I'd like to ask all of you, working in that way, does it feel freer or more confining to you? I mean, in some ways, it seems like it might provide an atmosphere for real things to happen, where you don't have to have a pace and a cut and a...
Well, yes, it was very helpful to me as a mostly a stage actor. Because I'm used to relying on the reality of progressions and emotions to carry me and to grow of themselves and to be sustained. But at the same time, we kept having lots of trouble with the long shots because they just take forever. And you'd get to the 7th minute and you're crossing your fingers that nothing goes wrong and you don't have to do it again.
Yeah.
So there was this mounting pressure with the long shots, even though there was that natural feeling to it. There's a whole lot of pressure to get it and get it done right this time, that made the filming process taxing.
Mm-hmm. Renee, in Hot Air, there's a noticeable lack of music, as opposed to some of your other films. Was that difficult? Was it difficult to read? Because I actually think that, you know, you've got quite a gift for the music that you use in your films. So if you could just speak a little bit about that.
Yeah. Once again, it goes with my editing. I feel like mixing music and images is the thing that I'm absolutely best at, the thing I enjoy most, mm-hmm. because it has such an immediate dramatic appeal. So with this film that had, which is something I want to talk about, the credit music, which I think is one of my favorite parts of the film. But between both ends of the credits, there's just about no music, and it really felt it. I felt watching it and editing it, I felt that music really makes the scene go places. It pushes it. It makes it more watchable. So when there's these long scenes without any music, it adds to that kind of like almost like grating fingernail on the chalkboard reality.
The silence is, yeah, it's unnerving in parts
mm-hmm.
of that movie,
mm-hmm.
and I think it's what makes it's lacking a certain kind of gloss because it doesn't have music, and at the same time I think that's a really powerful choice.
Yeah, yeah, I felt like it had to be that way. I thought
mm-hmm.
about putting music in the middle, the party scene. I thought about dropping some music in there, and I tried it, and it so stood out from the rest of the film. It was night and dark, and it didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to talk about, I think Elliot composed the music.
At the end of the
beginning
the credits,
and the
end.
And it goes along with the improvisational thing. It was this wonderful thing. We went over to his house, and I gave him sort of a sketch of what I wanted. I said I wanted to be Andy music. I wanted to be his character kind of transposed into music. And so we pounded out some different things. We liked certain things more,
mm-hmm.
and then we cut that away.
Mm-hmm.
And then it starts raining when we're recording.
It's great.
And so
it's like 11 at night, and starts raining outside, yeah.
And it's this beautiful rain that's having this wonderful, adding this great layer to the soundtrack. And then when we record the credits at the end, that thunderbolt that you hear at the end of the credits, that was not dropped in afterwards. That was perfectly queued up to the end of the song. He plays his last note, and there's this wonderful resounding thunderclap.
And it's like like I should go, and he's gonna stay and record some more rain, and
yeah,
it was great. But you know, you couldn't.
Well,
mess
it actually kind of was so captivating, the thunder at the end, because it continued on. Also, I found myself listening to it, going, it's still going on. So you didn't exactly know when it ended.
I love how sound does that.
Yeah.
I love like when you hear a bell. And it rings, and then it slowly dies, and then there's a point where you can't tell if you're just remembering it or if it's really there.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I know what you're talking about. I love that.
Thank you.
Well, what's up next for you?
Well, I've started a really exciting group called the Elevator Art Club, and we it's a fantastic thing. We meet twice a week or twice a month, and it's a support group where we bring new things that we have worked on, and we get feedback from people who we all respect, and that's tremendously helpful. And then also we work on group projects, like we're doing. We go to elevators in the middle of the night. We're going to do one tonight.
Are we?
Yeah. Elliot's part of it. And we decorate them with photographs, pictures, whatever. We make this environment inside the elevator, hence the name the Elevator Art Group. And we're also planning on doing
a huge opera, amazing multimedia play film.
Yeah. It's going to be a total multimedia very, very over the top with live music playing on the stage, actors interacting with that live music. It's going to be very exciting, and that's going to be done as a group. That's what I'm doing. What is everyone else doing?
I've been animating, and I have a puppet show I'm working on, and I'm in a sketch troupe that we're filming stuff called the Scrubby Neves. It's a lot of fun.
That's great.
Yeah.
I'd like to say that this is actually the room that the final scene in Julia Thompson, A Case Study, was filmed in, right about where Elliot's sitting. It was where Julia was tied to the chair being covered with food.
Yeah, I want to ask you about that a little bit, Leah, too. Like, how did you feel when you found out that you were going to have all this food dumped on you? And
you know, whenever I first imagined it, I thought it was going to be little things of food. And I came in, and it was these big, huge cafeteria canisters of different things. And a little-known not filmed scene was me in the bathtub at home going, oh my God, I'm going to have to shave my head because flour and milk turned to glue. And it was not coming out. So at like 4 in the morning, I have this huge cheap container of hair conditioner and a comb, and I'm just trying to comb that stuff out. Because I was like, I can't cut my hair because it has to be long tomorrow. Because
oh, yeah?
We filmed the last one first, so it was very... It was very fun. Oh, and a homeless person, as I was walking to my car, told me I stunk.
Oh, that's good.
That was really fun. It was an experience. But it was worth it. The film turned out really well.
Well, is there anything else you all would like to talk about the films or particular something we haven't covered?
I'd like to say that I feel very, very fortunate to be living in this place in this time. I think Austin is a very, very special place with a lot of incredibly talented people, and I loved working with Elliot, and I loved working with Leah, and I consider myself very lucky to know these people. And I am very glad that I... got to know you to make that connection.
Any possibility of you two?
Oh, God knows. Who knows? You may need an old fart sometime. You know, to be in something. Who knows?
It would be an honor to work with you.
It would be great. Yeah, that would be great.